thank you for joining us at the ordination and installation of Bishop-elect David Konderla to be the fourth bishop of Tulsa. My name is Father Simeon Spitz, and I'm a monk of St. Gregory's Abbey in Shawnee, Oklahoma.
And I'm here. My name is Dennis Maka. I am the president of Red Sea Catholic Radio in College Station, where Father David Konderla is from.
And we are joined here at the Reynolds on the campus of Tulsa University by many of the faithful from the Diocese of Tulsa, and also a great number of personal friends and family of Bishop-elect Konderla. A wonderful showing of the Fourth Degree Knights of Columbus, of course, many clergy from the Diocese of Tulsa, and a number of visiting bishops as well. Bishop Konderla is to be installed as the fourth bishop of Tulsa. The Tulsa Diocese had its origins originally as Indian Territory. Before the diocese existed, it was covered mostly out of the Diocese of Little Rock. The Bishop of Little Rock was at that time covering all of Arkansas and Oklahoma with only eight priests. In 1876, monks were sent out here to be the Prefect Apostolic of Indian Territory, and they covered as those Prefects Apostolic until 1891 with the arrival of Bishop Theophile Mearshart, who was a missionary from Belgium and came from the Diocese of Natchez, Mississippi, to be Bishop and Vicar Apostolic of Indian Territory, and ordained the first priest for the territory, Father William Ketchum, later that year. He was the first priest to celebrate Mass in Tulsa and laid the groundwork for the first Catholic parish in Tulsa, Holy Family, which is finally established in 1899. In 1887, Catherine Drexel founded a mission school for Osage girls at Pawhuska, followed a year later with a school for the boys at Gray House. In 1889, Drexel funded the construction of the future Holy Family Cathedral School as a school for Creek Indian girls. Mother Drexel visited northeastern Oklahoma several more times before her death in 1955. Mother Drexel was canonized a saint on October 1, 2000. In the 1920s, Bishop Francis C. Kelly attempted to move the chancery from Oklahoma City to Tulsa and make the newly constructed Christ the King Parish his cathedral. While this endeavor ultimately failed, it did lead to the diocese being redesignated as the Diocese of Oklahoma City and Tulsa, with Holy Family being elevated to a co-cathedral. In 1973, Pope Paul VI made Tulsa the see of a new diocese, encompassing the eastern third of the state, and named Bernard J. Gantar, a Texas A&M alumnus, as the first bishop of Tulsa and the world's first Aggie bishop. The Diocese of Tulsa is home to more than 63,000 Catholics in 77 parishes, representing about 3.5% of the population. Besides those of European ancestry, there are large populations of Native American Catholics, as well as Vietnamese, Burmese, and Hispanic Catholic immigrants. The diocese boasts of 3 Catholic hospitals in the city, 13 Catholic schools, and a model Catholic charities institution that serves approximately 50,000 people annually throughout its 14 programs in Tulsa and rural locations.
One thing that we are treated to here that you are not, as our viewing audience, is the Bishop Konderla's coat of arms, the explanation for that. So I would like to read to you now a little bit more about that to explain both the coat of arms and a little bit of an insight into the Bishop-elect Konderla's thinking and his ministry to come. The bishop's coat of arms is composed of 3 elements: a shield with its various symbols, a scroll with the bishop's motto, and the external ornaments of the cross and the tasseled hat. The color palette of the shield represents Bishop Konderla's family heritage from Germany, Poland, and Ireland. The 5-pointed star represents the Star of Bethlehem, which first announced the birth of our Savior. The star also represents the bishop's love for his native state of Texas. Detailing this, Bishop Konderla wrote, "I also find that looking up at the stars and the beauty of the universe draws me closer to the Creator of the universe." The intertwined A and M, surmounted with a cross, form the symbol known as the Auspice Maria. This translates, "under the protection of Mary." By adding this symbol to his shield, the new bishop acknowledges Our Lady's essential role in his priesthood and now in his life as bishop. He has placed his episcopacy under the care of Mary's prayer and protection. Its secondary meaning is a reference to Texas A&M University and to Bishop Konderla's beloved Aggies, whose logo is the ATM. The blue vertical line on his shield represents the three rivers that have run through the bishop's life. He grew up in the Brazos Valley, named for the Brazos River, and his home diocese is the Diocese of Austin, with the Colorado River running through it. His new Diocese of Tulsa is prominently marked by the Arkansas River. Rivers throughout the world form lines of connection between various peoples, and according to Psalm 46, it is a river that gladdens the city of God, the dwelling of the Most High. The scroll is inscribed with the new bishop's motto, Nisi Dominus Edificavreat. Well, that was terrible. Sorry about that, Father. The first three words of Psalm 126 from the Latin Vulgate Bible. It is translated, unless the Lord build. The psalm continues, unless the Lord builds the house, in vain do its builders labor. Unless the Lord watch over the city, in vain does the watchman keep vigil. In vain is your earlier rising and your going later to rest. You who toil for bread, you who eat, while he pours gifts on his beloved while they slumber. The psalm and the motto of Bishop Konderla's shield reminds us that God is ever near to help us, and without him, we cannot do what we need to do.
Now a little bit about Bishop-elect David Konderla himself. He's a native son of the Diocese of Austin, born on June the 3rd, 1960. He grew up in Bryan, the second of 12 children born to David and Ann Konderla. His father still lives in Bryan. His mother died in 2012. The bishop has 25 nieces and nephews, one of whom will be born this summer, and one great niece. After high school, Bishop Konderla worked as a machinist, but at the age of 23, experienced a deeper and more intentional conversion to living as a disciple of Jesus. This period marked a turning point in his life, and 2 years later, he entered the seminary, where he earned an undergraduate degree in history from the University of Dallas in 1989, and a Master of Divinity degree from the University of St. Thomas in 1995. The bishop was ordained a priest on June the 3rd, 1995, by Bishop John McCarthy. Bishop Konderla served as associate pastor in St. Louis King of France Parish, Austin, St. Luke Parish Temple, and finally at St. Mary Catholic Center in College Station from 1997 to 2001. In 2001, he was appointed the first full-time vocation director for the Diocese of Austin, a position that he held until 2005, when he was appointed as pastor of St. Mary Catholic Center in College Station. Of his 21 years as a priest, almost 15 of them have been with his beloved Aggies. Quote, being surrounded by so many young people and working with the staff who truly love the Lord and seek a deeper friendship with him have always given me courage to continue to fulfill the church's mission in the world, the bishop said. Over the years, Bishop Konderla has also served the Diocese of Austin with service on the Presbyteral Council, the Priest's Personal Board, the Pension Plan and Trust Board, as the director of Project Rachel Retreats, and as a chaplain for the Courage Apostolate at Texas A&M University. Now, Dennis, you know the bishop-elect personally.
I do.
What from his background do you think most stands out in preparing him for his role as the soon-to-be Bishop of Tulsa?
You know, what's nice about Texas and Oklahoma is we're often down-home folks. You know, we're very genuine, very simple, and I think that he has a very simple faith. He loves the Lord with all his heart, and he also is looking to spread God's love as simply as he can to all around him. And so he's not very difficult to get to know. He's also not very difficult to love. He's a wonderful man that opens his heart up to anyone and all around him. I think part of that comes from him coming from such a big family in our community of Bryan College Station. But it also does come from his ministry in working with Texas A&M, which has been known for its hospitality as a campus. It's very open and very simple in a lot of ways, very traditional campus. And so he fits in quite well. As many people have seen online on some of the videos of his place of respite out in the acreage in the Texas Hill Country, He's a very simple man. He does not need a lot of big city life or any, I would say, conveniences in life to survive. He has the Lord, and he has his little shack out there in the woods. And so...
Well, as a monk, that's very near and dear to my heart. Sometimes I wish I could get away from it all completely and have my hermitage in the woods.
But he's very simple to get to know, and like as I mentioned, very simple and easy to love, endearing himself to so many. And speaking of Father David Konderla, Bishop-elect Konderla has now entered the arena, and followed by many, many other bishops as well.
We truly feel a part of the church militant today as we see this small army of bishops gathered here for this celebration. Joining with us again are a number of bishops, including Bishop Daniel Garcia, Auxiliary Bishop of Austin.
Bishop Danny Garcia was our most recently ordained and our newest bishop here in Austin, the Diocese of Austin. Actually, the brand new first auxiliary bishop for the Diocese of Austin. We were privileged to be able to broadcast his ordination a couple of years ago, actually just early this last year. So he's been our newest prelate there in the Diocese of Austin. We also have Bishop Mike Siss, who is a very good friend of Bishop-elect Konderla. In fact, not many Catholic schools can boast that they have two classmates that have become Catholic priests. Now St. Joseph's Catholic School in Bryan can also boast they have two classmates that have become Catholic bishops, indeed.
Also with us today is Bishop Edward Weisenberger, Bishop of Salinas. Bishop Weisenberger is, of course, a native Oklahoman.
We also have Bishop Joseph Strickland, who is the Bishop of Tyler, Texas. Bishop Strickland was born in Fredericksburg, Texas, and moved to Atlanta, Texas as a child, and he attended Holy Trinity Seminary, and was ordained to the priesthood June 1st of 1985, just about 10 years prior to Bishop-elect Konderla.
Bishop Edward Navarez, Auxiliary Bishop of Phoenix, born in San Antonio, Texas, and was ordained to the priesthood in 1981.
Followed behind Bishop Eduardo Navarez is Bishop Mark Seitz, the Bishop of El Paso, Texas. Bishop Seitz was born in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and was ordained to the priesthood by Bishop Thomas Shapey in Texas in 1980.
Bishop Anthony Taylor, present Bishop of Little Rock, was born in Fort Worth, Texas, lived in Ponca City, Oklahoma, and was ordained to the priesthood in 1980. His first assignment was at Sacred Heart Parish in Oklahoma City, and within a month of his ordination, had begun to celebrate Mass in Spanish twice a month in Clinton and Hinton, Oklahoma, ordained a bishop in April 2008.
Also in attendance is Bishop Patrick Zurich, Bishop of Amarillo, Texas. He was ordained a priest in 1975. He served for 21 years in the Diocese of Austin, including time in College Station. Archbishop Joseph Fiorenza, our Bishop Emeritus, Archbishop Emeritus for the Diocese of Galveston, Houston, is also here, along with
Archbishop Beltran, the Metropolitan Archbishop Emeritus of Oklahoma City, and the second former bishop of Tulsa Diocese. He was born in Ashley, Pennsylvania, and aspired to become a missionary, becoming a seminarian of the Diocese of Savannah. He was ordained to the priesthood in 1960, ordained a bishop in 1978 as the Bishop of Tulsa.
And Archbishop Gregory Amon is also here, who is the current Archbishop of New Orleans. He was born in New Orleans and attended Notre Dame Seminary in New Orleans. He was ordained a priest in 1975. In June 2000, he was named coadjutor Bishop of Austin, Texas. In 2009, he was appointed as Archbishop of New Orleans.
And now, making his approach to the altar, the Most Reverend Paul Coakley, Metropolitan Archbishop of Oklahoma City and Principal Consecrator today. Born in Norfolk, Virginia, ordained to the priesthood in May 1983. He then served as chaplain at St. Francis Regional Medical Center in Wichita from June to August 1983 and as associate pastor at St. Mary's Church in Derby from 1983 to 1985. He served as chaplain at Kansas Newman College from 1987 to 1989. He was also director of the Youth and Young Adult Ministries Office and pastor of Our Lady of Guadalupe Church, 1989 to 1990. From 1990 to 1995, he served as associate director of the Spiritual Life Center and associate pastor of St. Thomas Aquinas Church. He served as pastor of the Church of the Resurrection from 1995 to 1998, and he was ordained as bishop December 2004.
Our co-consecrators today is Most Reverend Joe Vasquez, the Bishop of Austin. He was born in Stamford, Texas, ordained to the priesthood in June 1984. He then served as parochial vicar at St. Joseph's Church in Odessa until 1987. From 97 to 2002, he served as pastor of St. Joseph's Church in San Angelo and was ordained our bishop in January 2002. In January of 2010, he was named the Bishop of Austin Diocese. And finally,
the Most Reverend Edward Slattery, Bishop Emeritus of Tulsa, born in Chicago, Illinois, ordained to the priesthood in April 1966. He served as associate pastor of St. Jude the Apostle Parish in South Holland until 1971. He later served as associate pastor at the inner city Hispanic Parish of St. Rose of Lima, ordained Bishop of Tulsa in January 1994, and the current acting administrator.
Peace be with you. My brothers and sisters, we come together in joy this day as we celebrate with the Church the solemnity of the holy apostles, Peter and Paul. And as we have the joy of conferring the fullness of the sacrament of holy orders upon Bishop-elect David Konderla as fourth bishop of Tulsa. Let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mystery. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all of the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, who on the solemnity of the apostles Peter and Paul, give us the noble and holy joy of this day, grant, we pray, that your church may in all things follow the teaching of those through whom she received the beginnings of right religion. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
Lectura de los Hechos de los Apóstoles. En aquellos días, el rey David Herodes mandó apresar a algunos miembros de la iglesia para maltratarlos. Mandó pasar a cuchillo a Santiago, hermano de Juan, y viendo que eso agradaba a los judíos, también hizo apresar a Pedro. Esto sucedió durante los días de la fiesta de los panes ácimos. Después de apresarlo, lo hizo encarcelar y lo puso bajo la vigilancia de 4 turnos de guardia, de 4 soldados cada turno. Su intención era hacerlo comparecer ante el pueblo después de la Pascua. Mientras Pedro estaba en la cárcel, la comunidad no cesaba de orar a Dios por él. La noche anterior, al día en que Herodes iba a hacerlo comparecer ante el pueblo, Pedro estaba durmiendo entre 2 soldados, atado con 2 cadenas, y los centinelas lo cuidaban. De pronto apareció el ángel del Señor y el calabozo se llenó de luz. El ángel tocó a Pedro en el costado y lo despertó y le dijo: «Levántate pronto». Entonces las cadenas que lo sujetaban las manos se le cayeron. El ángel le dijo: «Cíñete la túnica y ponte las sandalias», y Pedro obedeció. Después le dijo: «Ponte el manto y sígueme». Pedro salió detrás de él, sin saber si era verdad o no lo que el ángel hacía, y le parecía más bien que estaba soñando. Pasaron el primero y el segundo puesto de guardia, y llegaron a la puerta de hierro que daba a la calle. La puerta se abrió sola delante de ellos. Salieron y caminaron hasta la esquina de la calle, y de pronto el ángel desapareció. Entonces Pedro se dio cuenta de lo que pasaba y dijo: «Ahora sí estoy seguro de que el Señor envió a su ángel para librarme de las manos de Herodes y de todo cuanto el pueblo judío esperaba que me hicieran». Palabra del Señor.
Chức sách tông đồ công vụ. Trong những ngày ấy, vua Herode làm khổ mấy người trong hội thánh. Ông đã dùng gươm giết Giacôbê và anh của Gioan. Ông thấy việc ấy đẹp lòng người Do Thái, nên lại cho bắt cả Phêrô. Bấy giờ là ngày lễ bánh không men. Bắt được người, vua cho tống ngục, giao cho bọn đội binh, mỗi đội 4 người canh giữ, có ý đợi sau lễ vượt qua sẽ điệu người ra cho dân. Phêrô bị giam trong ngục, nhưng hội thánh vẫn luôn luôn cầu nguyện cùng Chúa cho người. Đến khi vua Herode sắp điệu người ra, thì đêm ấy Phêrô phải mang xiềng xích nằm ngủ giữa 2 tên lính và có quân canh giữ trước cửa ngục. Bỗng có thiên thần Chúa đứng kề bên một luồng ánh sáng chiếu rải vào ngục. Thiên thần đập vào cạnh sườn Phêrô, đánh thức người dậy mà rằng: hãy trỗi dậy mau. Xiềng xích liền rơi khỏi tay người. Thiên thần bảo người rằng: hãy thắt lưng và mang giày vào. Người làm y như vậy. Thiên thần lại bảo rằng: hãy khoác áo vào mà theo ta. Người liền đi ra theo thiên thần, mà chẳng biết việc thiên thần làm có thật chăng. Người tưởng như trong giấc mộng. Qua khỏi trạng thứ nhất và trạng thứ hai, thì đến cửa sắt thông ra thành. Cửa ấy tự nhiên mở ra. Thiên thần và Phêrô rảo qua một phố nọ, rồi thiên thần biến đi. Phêrô hoàn hồn và nói rằng: bây giờ tôi biết thật Chúa đã sai thiên thần cứu tôi khỏi tay Hê-rô-đê và khỏi mọi âm mưu của dân Do Thái. Đó là lời Chúa.
The word of the Lord.
Mr. Ernest Neal, principal organist at the cathedral, will be the psalmist today, and Mr. Lyndon Meyer from St. Mary's Parish will accompany him on the organ.
The angel of the Lord will rescue those who fear him.
Our second reading will also be proclaimed twice, first in English by Sister Tatum McWhorter from the Apostles of the Interior Life from St. Mary's Catholic Center in College Station, and a second time in Zomi by Teresa Hao Vung from Immaculate Heart of Mary Parish in Tulsa.
A reading from the second epistle of St. Paul to Timothy. For this reason, I remind you to stir into flame the gift of God that you have through the imposition of my hands. For God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather of power and love and self-control. So do not be ashamed of your testimony to our Lord, nor of me, a prisoner for his sake. But bear your share of hardship for the gospel with the strength that comes from God. He saved us and called us to a holy life, not according to our works, but according to his own design and the grace bestowed on us in Christ Jesus before time began, but now made manifest through the appearance of our Savior Christ Jesus, who destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, for which I was appointed preacher and apostle and teacher. On this account, I am suffering these things, but I am not ashamed, for I know him in whom I have believed and am confident that he is able to guard what he has entrusted to me until that day. Take as your norm the sound words that you heard from me, in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Guard this rich trust with the help of the Holy Spirit that dwells within us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lai Siang Chou Nina. Timothy tunga Paul lai khak ni na sungpan simna hi hi to hi manin nang tunga ka khun nga in thu ka hong nge sak lai in nang ma tunga pasian in hong piak siam na na no so an ding in ka hong phok sa hi bang hang hiam chi le pasian in eite tunga mei doi na lung sim hong kwan lowa Chahana, Kiina, Pumpi Kyuzona, Lungsim, Hongguan, Hizohi. Toahi Manin, Itoba to gain Nadin Tua Ahia. Ama to hang in Tongakia, Kema Tua Ahizong in, Maizum Het Kay in. Pasianin, Nangma Tunga, Chahana, Hongpia, Hima Bangin, Lungdamna to hang in. Thuak na zong athuak nuam hi zo in eite sep zona hang hi lo in amangim na sabang le ading na hang in pasianin eite hong hon khia in ama mi ding in a hong sam hi pasianin leitung apian ma pekin Christu Yesu tung tonin tua ding na a hong pia khia Tuun chang in eite hong hon pa Christu Yesu tung ton in adik na hong lang sakta hi Toa Yesu in si na be saka lungdam na chu hang in si non lo na chu a hong kilang sahi Hi atak lungdam na chu hil in atang ko ding le sol tang na asem ding in kei a hong ki koi a hi hi toa hi manin hi bang teng athwa ka hi hi a hi zong in ka upa ka theya ama tunga ka ap te toa ni dong hong kep sak zo ding hi chi in thei ka hi manin ka mai zum het kei hi kei ma tung panin na zak sa aman thu te zu in la Christu Yisu to ikipol na hangin, inga upna le ina tua kiptak in om in. The word of the Lord.
The Gospel today will be proclaimed in both English and Spanish by the Deacon of the Gospel, Deacon Jose Guzman. After the Gospel is proclaimed, the Book of the Gospels will be returned to the altar, where it will be placed upon the head of Bishop-elect Konderla during the ordination ritual.
When Jesus went into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter said in reply, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus said to him in reply, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my heavenly Father. And so I say to you, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of the netherworld shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. En aquel tiempo, cuando llegó Jesús a la región de Cesarea de Filipo, hizo esta pregunta a sus discípulos: ¿Quién dice la gente que es el Hijo del Hombre? Ellos le respondieron: Unos dicen que eres Juan el Bautista, otros que Elías, otros que Jeremías, o alguno de los profetas. Luego les preguntó: ¿Y ustedes quién dicen que soy yo? Simón Pedro tomó la palabra y le dijo: Tú eres el Mesías, el Hijo de Dios vivo. Jesús le dijo entonces: Dichosos tú, Simón, hijo de Juan, porque esto no te lo ha revelado ningún hombre, sino mi Padre que está en los cielos. Y yo te digo a ti que tú eres Pedro, y sobre esta piedra edificaré mi iglesia. Los poderes del infierno no prevalecerán sobre ella. Yo te daré las llaves del reino de los cielos. Todo lo que ates en la tierra quedará atado en el cielo, y todo lo que desates en la tierra quedará desatado en el cielo. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
As we now enter the rite of ordination, Bishop-elect Konderla will be presented to the primary consecrating bishop, after which a presentation will be read by Archbishop Christoph Pierre, Apostolic Nuncio. After the papal mandate is read, all people will give their assent by responding, "Thanks be to God." For those of you listening in, you are most welcome to join in this acclamation, joining your prayers with those here present, that we do in thanks give God for the new Bishop of Tulsa.
Currently, the Holy Spirit is being invoked with the singing of the Veni Creator.
Thank you.
Church of Tulsa ask you to ordain this priest, David Konderla, to the responsibility of the episcopate.
Have you a mandate from the Apostolic See?
We have.
Let it be read.
Let the College of Consultors examine the apostolic mandate.
Your Excellency, Paul Coakley, Metropolitan Archbishop of Oklahoma City. Your Excellencies, Bishops Edward Slattery and Joe Vasquez. Your Excellency, Bishop-elect David Konderla. My brother Archbishops and Bishops, dear priests, deacons, consecrated religious and lay faithful of the Church in Tulsa, dear friends, at the beginning of my mission in the United States of America as the Holy Father's personal representative, I consider it a great honor to start here in the Diocese of Tulsa and to share your joy as Father David Konderla is ordained to the fullness of the priesthood and solemnly installed as the fourth bishop of this young local church. I hope it is true that it is a young church. It should be. And what a beautiful feast today is, the solemnity of Saints Peter and Paul, apostles, a day that unites in a special way with our Holy Father, Pope Francis. In the Gospel of John, chapter 10, Jesus, the Son of God, offers in just a few words a model for all bishops. I am the good shepherd, and I know mine, and mine know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. In sacred scripture, to know is much more than something intellectual. It means a living, vital, profound communion of love, reflecting the life of the Blessed Trinity itself. Dear Bishop-elect Konderla, we are confident that in your daily episcopal ministry to the clergy and faithful, being entrusted to your pastoral care, as well as to the community at large, you will exemplify what Pope Francis recently said in a homily during episcopal ordinations. In the church entrusted to you, be faithful custodians and dispensers of the mysteries of Christ. As the Father has placed you as the head of his family, always follow the example of the Good Shepherd, who knows his sheep. Behind every document, there is a person. Behind every letter that you receive, there is a person. May these people be known to you, and may you be capable of knowing them. On this occasion, I would also like to thank you, Bishop Edward Slattery, for your dedicated leadership as the third, is that correct? The third one. You know, I'm quite new, I have to learn. Okay. As the third Bishop of Tulsa for more than 20 years. That's correct also. I believe that the challenge will be big for the successor. And now I will read for you the apostolic letter of appointment. Francis, Bishop, servant of the servants of God, to our beloved son, David Austin Konderla, from the clergy of the Diocese of Austin and until now pastor there of St. Mary Catholic Center of at Texas University. I will not repeat it. So at Texas A&M University in College Station, appointed Bishop of Tulsa, greetings and apostolic blessing. This is the Pope speaking. The Church has but one sole purpose, that the kingdom of God may come, and that the salvation of the whole human race may be accomplished. We, for our part, as the successor of Peter, take great pains to proclaim diligently to all the faithful the gospel of the kingdom of God, as we strive to provide carefully for their spiritual needs. For this reason, since the Cathedral See of Tulsa is currently vacant, owing to the resignation of our venerable brother Edward James Slattery, we ourselves have turned our thoughts to you, beloved son, as one who not only clearly shows the appropriate human and Christian qualities, but also who has acquired great pastoral experience in the administration of parishes in your native Diocese of Austin, as well as in various councils. Therefore, upon consultation with the congregations for bishops, by virtue of our apostolic authority, we appoint you Ordinary of Tulsa, conferring upon you all the requisite rights and relative obligations which are connected to this mandate. First, you must make the profession of faith and take the oath of fidelity to us and our successors in compliance with the laws and norms of the Church. After this, you may receive episcopal ordination from any Catholic bishop outside the city of Rome, the liturgical precepts being observed. In addition, you must inform the clergy and Christ faithful entrusted to your pastoral care about this, our decree. And we exhort all of them, with you as their spiritual leader, to heed continually each day, with ever greater diligence, the divine teaching, thus manifesting the living presence of the kingdom of God in the world. Finally, beloved son, it is our earnest desire that you devote all your energy, ever more so each day, to the spiritual progress of your faithful, trusting always in the divine teacher and the most blessed mother of the Redeemer, whom we lovingly honor in a special way during this month of May. Given at Rome, at St. Peter's, on the 13th day of the month of May, in the year of the Lord 2016, during the Jubilee of Mercy, the fourth of our pontificate, it is signed Francis and Francesco di Felice, Protonotary Apostolic.
This apostolic letter demonstrates how the authority of the local bishop, conferred by the laying on of hands and the conferral of the Holy Spirit, is exercised with and confirmed by the Holy See.
Apostolic mandate.
An attending deacon from his place then gives the instruction for the mandate to be inspected. The ministering deacon stands and takes the apostolic mandate that he might show it to the consultors. After showing the mandate,
the apostolic mandate be shown to the people.
He is now given instructions for the mandate to be shown to all the people in attendance. In response to the showing of this mandate, the assembly may show their consent by singing Psalm 117.
I will give you shepherds after my own heart. Through these words of the prophet Jeremiah, God promises that he will never, ever leave his flock untended. And God keeps his promises. Today we rejoice that through our beloved Holy Father, Pope Francis, God has provided a shepherd for the Church of Tulsa in the person of Bishop-elect David Konderla, formerly a priest of Austin and soon to be ordained as the fourth Bishop of Tulsa. Along with our nuncio, I want to take this opportunity to publicly acknowledge and thank Bishop Slattery for his 22 years of pastoral care, devoted service to the Church of Eastern Oklahoma. Bishop Slattery, you have indeed been a good shepherd, and we are very, very grateful. And of course, it is a tremendous privilege, a very special privilege, to have with us Archbishop Christophe Pierre, the Apostolic Nuncio to the United States. As Nuncio, Archbishop Pierre is the Pope's personal representative to the Church in the United States, as well as the ambassador of the Holy See to this country. This is Archbishop Pierre's first episcopal ordination and installation since arriving in the United States only a few weeks ago. Your Excellency, we are very, very grateful you honor us by your presence. And it is, of course, a great pleasure to have so many of my brother bishops and priests and deacons with us today. In a particular way, I would like to take this opportunity to acknowledge the presence of the second Bishop of Tulsa, Archbishop Beltran, my predecessor in Oklahoma City, and Bishop Slattery's predecessor here in Tulsa. He too is a good shepherd. Today is a day of great thanksgiving, rejoicing for the whole church. And it is a joy to share this day with so many religious women and men, so many members of the lay faithful, from across our province, Oklahoma and Arkansas, but also from Texas and beyond. We have many ecumenical and interfaith leaders here, civic officials. We're grateful that you have joined us. You honor us. It is certainly a good thing that Bishop-elect Konderla opted for this larger venue, because I gather that his family alone, not to mention his beloved Aggie family, who accompanied him across the Red River, much as Moses accompanied into the Promised Land. We are grateful to each and every one of you for being with us to share the joy of this day. It is a day of rejoicing for indeed the whole church. And what a privilege, what a great blessing it is to be able to celebrate this day and this occasion, this event, and the solemnity of the holy apostles, Peter and Paul. These two pillars of the church have been honored together on this date since the very earliest centuries. God's mysterious providence brought these two very, very different men together to share a common path and to share a common crown. Peter began life known as Simon, a fisherman from Galilee. Paul, until he encountered the risen Lord on the road to Damascus, was known as Saul. He had been a Pharisee, learned in the law, and a fierce persecutor of the church. But God had other plans for both of them. It was God's mysterious choice of each of them and their generous response that led them ultimately to share the martyr's crown in Rome. What a beautiful day to be ordained as a successor to the apostles, as the whole church honors these two princes of the apostles. I suspect you, Father David, might be just as amazed as these two saints we honor today must have been at the mysterious ways of God, who has guided your life's journey, and through the encounter with Christ, led you first to seminary, then to priesthood, and now to the fullness of the priesthood as bishop. In order to respond wholeheartedly to God's prompting in life, it is not enough to satisfy ourselves with being able to answer the question that Jesus poses in the gospel today: who do people say that I am, or the Son of Man is? We can, in fact, learn that from a book. But Jesus presses his disciples as he presses us. Who do you say that I am? Who am I for you? Who am I to you? This is a question nobody else can answer for any of us. It requires a personal response. Peter and Paul both had those 4 o'clock moments that Pope Francis calls those unforgettable events through which we encounter the Lord's love and mercy in our lives in ways that mark and change us forever. This encounter with mercy invites a personal, heartfelt response and becomes the foundation for a deep friendship with Jesus and for a lifelong journey of discipleship. and it is at the heart of every Christian vocation. As in the case of Saul and Simon, the encounter is transformative, bringing a new identity and a new mission. And I say to you, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. Our son, our brother, our friend, our pastor, Father David, has encountered the overwhelming love of God in the face of Jesus Christ. He has given his life to following Jesus. And the same Lord who is faithful and has called him to the priesthood now calls him to a new mission of service in the life of the church as a bishop. Let's consider then the nature of this new mission, this new calling, this new rank in the church to which our brother, Father David, is about to be raised. Our Lord Jesus Christ, who was sent by the Father to redeem the human race, in turn sent 12 apostles into the world. They were filled with the power of the Holy Spirit to preach the gospel and to sanctify and govern all the peoples gathered into one flock. Moreover, that this office might remain until the end of time, the apostles chose helpers for themselves through the laying on of hands by which the fullness of the sacrament of holy orders is conferred. They handed on to them the gift of the Holy Spirit, which they had received from Christ. In that way, the tradition handed down from the beginning through the unbroken succession of bishops is preserved from generation to generation, and the work of the Savior continues even to our own time. In the bishop, surrounded by his priests, our Lord Jesus Christ himself, having become high priest forever, is present among you. For through the ministry of the bishop, Christ himself never fails to proclaim the gospel and to administer the sacraments of faith to those who believe. Through the bishop's exercise of his duty as father, Christ himself adds new members to his body, the church. Through the bishop's wisdom and prudence, it is Christ himself who leads you in your earthly pilgrimage toward eternal happiness. Gladly then, indeed gratefully, we welcome our brother, whom we, the bishops, now admit to the Episcopal College by the laying on of our hands. Revere him as a minister of Christ and a steward of the mysteries of God. He has been entrusted by the Vicar of Christ, Pope Francis, with the task of bearing witness to the truth of the gospel and with the ministry of the Spirit and of justice. Remember the words Christ spoke to the apostle: whoever listens to you listens to me, and whoever rejects you rejects me, and whoever rejects me rejects the one who sent me. Now, my dear brother, you have been chosen by the Lord. Consider that you are chosen from among men and appointed on their behalf for those things that pertain to God. The title of bishop is always a title of service, not a title of honor. And therefore, a bishop should strive always to benefit others rather than lord it over them. Such is the precept of our master: the greater should behave as the least, and the ruler always as the servant of the servants of God. Preach the word in season and out of season. Guide others with all patience, with all sound teaching, with all kindness and with firmness. As you pray, which you must, and offer sacrifice for the people committed to your care, devote yourself wholeheartedly to seeking every kind of grace for them from the fullness of Christ's holiness. In the church entrusted to you, this beautiful church of Tulsa, be a faithful steward and guardian of the mysteries of Christ. Since you are chosen by the Father to rule over his family, be mindful always of the Good Shepherd, who knows his sheep and is known by them, and who did not hesitate to lay down his life for them. This is your model. With the charity of a father and a brother and a friend, love all whom God places in your care, but especially your priests and deacons, who are your co-workers in the ministry of Christ. And also, of course, the poor, the weak, the immigrant, the strangers, who will always have a special claim on your pastoral heart. Encourage the faithful to work with you in your apostolic labor. Value their insights, value their gifts, value their wisdom and experience, and do not refuse to listen willingly to them. Finally, never overlook your concern for those who are not yet gathered into the one fold of Christ, those who have not yet heard the good news, those who are estranged, those who are on the margins, those who are forgotten, the invisible. They too are entrusted to your care in the Lord. Never forget that you are joined to the College of Bishops of the Holy Catholic Church, made one by the bond of charity, and therefore you should always also have a constant concern for all the churches and gladly come to the support of churches in need. And so keep watch, be vigilant over the whole flock in which the Holy Spirit appoints you to govern the Church of God, in the name of the Father, whose image you represent in the Church, and in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, whose office of teacher, priest, and shepherd you will discharge, and in the name of the Holy Spirit, who gives light, life to the Church of Christ, and by his power strengthens each of us in our weakness. May God, who has begun this good work in you, bring it to completion.
Having exhorted the bishop-elect into the offices of duties of the role of bishop, Bishop-elect Konderla will now be invited to make his profession of faith. As the bishop-elect answers each of the questions posed to him in a clear voice, the sum total of these promises is the entire life's work of a bishop, and ultimately what he will be judged on at the time of his death.
The ancient rule of the Holy Fathers ordains that a bishop-elect is to be questioned in the presence of the people on his resolve to uphold the faith and to discharge his duties. And so, dear brother, do you resolve by the grace of the Holy Spirit to discharge until death the office entrusted to us by the apostles, which we are about to pass on to you by the laying on of our hands?
I do.
Do you resolve to preach the gospel of Christ with constancy and fidelity?
I do.
Do you resolve to guard the deposit of faith entire and incorrupt
as handed down by the apostles and preserved in the church everywhere and at all times.
I do.
Do you resolve to build up the body of Christ, his church, and to remain in the unity of that body together with the order of bishops under the authority of the successor of St. Peter the Apostle?
I do.
Do you resolve to render obedience faithfully to the successor of the blessed Apostle Peter?
I do.
Do you resolve to guide the holy people of God in the way of salvation as a devoted father and sustain them with the help of your fellow ministers, the priests and deacons?
I do.
Do you resolve for the sake of the Lord's name to be welcoming and merciful to the poor, to strangers, and to all who are in need?
I do.
Do you resolve as a good shepherd to seek out the sheep who stray and gather them into the Lord's fold?
I do.
Do you resolve to pray without ceasing to Almighty God for the holy people and to carry out the office of high priest without reproach?
I do, with the help of God.
May God, who has begun the good work in you, bring it to fulfillment.
Amen.
The final confident promise and the response by Archbishop Coakley acknowledges that nothing is possible without the help of God. In the litany which follows, all the saints in heaven are asked to intercede on behalf of the man to be ordained bishop.
Dearly beloved, let us pray that the kindness of Almighty God in providing for the welfare of the church will grant an abundance of his grace for this, his chosen one.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Holy Mary, Mother of God,
pray for us.
Saint Michael,
pray for us.
Holy angels of God,
pray for us.
Saint John the Baptist,
pray for us.
Saint Joseph,
pray for us.
All you holy patriarchs and prophets,
pray for us.
Saint Peter,
pray for us.
Saint Paul,
pray for us.
Saint Andrew,
pray for us.
Saint James,
pray for us.
Saint John,
pray for us.
Saint Thomas,
pray for us.
Saint James,
pray for us.
Saint Philip,
pray for us.
Saint Bartholomew,
pray for us.
Saint Matthew,
pray for us.
Saint Simon,
pray for us.
Saint Jude,
pray for us.
Saint Matthias,
pray for us.
Saint Mark,
pray for us.
Saint Luke,
pray for us.
All you holy apostles and evangelists,
pray for us.
Saint Mary Magdalene,
pray for us.
Saint Stephen, proto-martyr,
pray for us.
Saint Ignatius of Antioch.
Pray for us.
Saint Lawrence.
Pray for us.
Saint Perpetua and Saint Felicity.
Pray for us.
Saint Agnes.
Pray for us.
Saint Catherine of Alexandria.
Pray for us.
Saint Gregory.
Pray for us.
Saint Augustine.
Pray for us.
Saint Athanasius.
Pray for us.
Saint Basil.
Pray for us.
Saint Martin of Tours.
Pray for us.
Saint Benedict.
Pray for us.
Saint Bernard of Clairvaux.
Pray for us.
Saint Francis and Saint Dominic.
Pray for us.
Saint Thomas Aquinas.
Pray for us.
Saint Anthony of Padua.
Pray for us.
Saint Francis Xavier.
Pray for us.
Saint Catherine of Siena.
Pray for us.
Saint Teresa of Jesus.
Pray for us.
Saint Marguerite Bourgeois.
Pray for us.
Saint Isaac Jogues and all you North American martyrs.
Pray for us.
Saint Andre Dung Lac and all you Proto martyrs of Vietnam.
Pray for us.
Blessed Miguel Pro and all you martyrs of Mexico.
Pray for us.
All you holy martyrs of every land and people.
Pray for us.
Saint John Marie Vianney.
Pray for us.
Saint Therese of Lisieux.
Pray for us.
Saint Benedict of the Cross.
Pray for us.
Saint Maximilian Kolbe.
Pray for us.
All you holy doctors and confessors.
Pray for us.
Saint John the 13th.
Pray for us.
Saint John Paul the 2nd.
Pray for us.
Saint Margaret Mary Alcock.
Pray for us.
Saint Faustina Kowalska.
Pray for us.
Saint Kateri Tekakwitha.
Pray for us.
Saint Junipero Serra.
Pray for us.
Saint Elizabeth Ann Seton.
Pray for us.
Saint John Newman.
Pray for us.
Saint Theodore Guerin.
Pray for us.
Saint Rose Philippine Duquesne.
Pray for us.
Saint Marianne Cope.
Pray for us.
Saint Francis Xavier Cabrini.
Pray for us.
Saint Damian of Molokai.
Pray for us.
Saint Catherine Drexel.
Pray for us.
All you holy men and women.
Pray for us.
All you saints of God.
Pray for us.
Lord, be merciful.
Lord, save your people.
From all evil.
Lord, save your people.
From every sin.
Lord, save your people.
From everlasting death.
Lord, save your people.
By your holy incarnation.
Lord, save your people.
By your death and life-giving resurrection.
Lord, save your people.
by the outpouring of the Holy Spirit.
Lord, save your people.
Be merciful to us sinners.
Lord, we ask you, hear our prayer.
Govern and protect your holy church.
Lord, we ask you, hear our prayer.
Keep the Pope and all the ordained in faithful service to your church.
Lord, we ask you, hear our prayer.
Bless this chosen man.
Lord, we ask you, hear our prayer.
Bless and sanctify this chosen man.
Lord, we ask you, hear our prayer.
Bless, sanctify, and consecrate this chosen man.
Lord, we ask you, hear our prayer.
Bring all peoples together in peace and true harmony.
Lord, we ask you, hear our prayer.
Comfort with your mercy the troubled and the afflicted.
Lord, we ask you, hear our prayer.
Strengthen all of us and keep us in your holy service.
Lord, we ask you, hear our prayer.
Jesus, Son of the living God.
Lord, we ask you, hear our prayer.
Christ, hear us.
Christ, hear us.
Christ, graciously hear us.
Christ, graciously hear us.
Graciously hear our petitions, O Lord, and pour out upon this your servant the power of your blessing, flowing from the horn of priestly grace, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
With the conclusion of the litany, now proceeds the laying on of the hands. In accordance with the ancient apostolic tradition, the sacrament is conferred through the imposition of hands in prayer. This action expresses the invocation, conferral, and action of the Holy Spirit, who configures the new bishop more perfectly to Christ the High Priest. The ritual requires that the principal consecrator and the two co-consecrators each lay hands on the newly ordained. Here today, each of the bishops present will each lay hands in turn as a sign of their collegiality of the office of bishop, its universal authority, and brotherhood.
God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Father of mercies and God of all consolation, who dwell on high and look upon the lowly, who know all things before they come to be, and who laid down observances in your church through your word of grace, who from the beginning foreordained a nation of the just, born of Abraham, who established rulers and priests, and did not leave your sanctuary without ministers, and who from the foundation of the world were pleased to be glorified in those you have chosen. Pour out now upon this chosen one that power which is from you, the governing spirit, whom you gave to your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, the spirit whom he bestowed upon the holy apostles, who established the church in each place as your sanctuary for the glory and unceasing praise of your name. Grant, O Father, knower of all hearts, that this your servant, whom you have chosen for the office of bishop, may shepherd your holy flock, serving you night and day. May he fulfill before you without reproach the ministry of the high priesthood, so that always gaining your favor, he may offer up the gifts of your holy church. Grant that by the power of the Spirit of the high priesthood, he may have the power to forgive sins according to your command, assign offices according to your decree, and loose every bond according to the power given by you to the apostles. May he please you by his meekness and purity of heart, presenting a fragrant offering to you through your Son, Jesus Christ, through whom glory and power and honor are yours with the Holy Spirit in the Holy Church, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen.
The principal ordaining bishop puts on a linen grimoire and, receiving from the deacon the chrism, anoints the head of the newly ordained bishop, who kneels before him.
This anointing with sacred chrism is a symbol of the high priesthood. Every priest is ordained unto the priesthood, but the bishop alone shares in the high priesthood of Jesus Christ. This anointing of the head follows the anointing of the hands, which proceeded from the priestly ordination.
May God who made you a sharer of the high priesthood of Christ himself pour out upon you the oil of mystical anointing and make you fruitful with an abundance of spiritual blessing.
As the Psalms say, how good and how precious it is when brothers live in unity. It is like precious oil upon the head, running down upon the beard, upon Aaron's beard, upon the collar of his robes. This anointing with chrism dates back thousands of years. Just as David was consecrated as king and priest of Israel, so now Bishop Konderla is consecrated with sacred chrism.
Given various symbols of his office. First, the book of the Gospels. The book of Gospels symbolizes his responsibility to preach the good news in season and out.
Receive the gospel and preach the word of God with all patience and sound teaching.
The ordaining bishop places the ring on the ring finger of the newly ordained bishop's right hand, saying the following prayer.
Receive this ring, the seal of fidelity, adorned with undefiled faith. Preserve unblemished the bride of God, the Holy Church.
The ring symbolizes the marriage of the bishop with his diocese. Next, the mitre.
Receive the mitre, and may the splendor of holiness shine forth in you, so that when the chief shepherd appears, you may deserve to receive from him an unfading crown of glory.
The mitre signifies the resolve of the new bishop to pursue holiness and purity of heart.
Receive the crozier, the sign of your pastoral office, and keep watch over the whole flock in which the Holy Spirit has placed you as bishop to govern the Church of God.
The crozier which Bishop Konderla has made himself symbolizes the bishop's charge to govern the diocese with the loving care of a good shepherd. Each of the bishops in turn afford Bishop Konderla the sign of peace. The fraternal kiss symbolizes the communion Bishop Konderla has with the College of Bishops, through which he manifests the union of the faithful in the Diocese of Tulsa with the Universal Church. This common office of bishop is shared by all bishops. Bishops who, by divine institution, succeed to the place of the apostles through the Holy Spirit that has been given to them, are constituted pastors of the Church, so that they are teachers of doctrine, priests of sacred worship, and ministers of governance. Through episcopal consecration itself, bishops receive, with the function of sanctifying, also the functions of teaching and governing. By their nature, however, these can only be exercised in hierarchical communion with the head and members of the college.
Let us stand together so that we may profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
and now bringing up the gifts to present to Bishop Konderla are his many siblings.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and all the church.
We place these offerings on your altar, O Lord, to celebrate with fitting honor the nativity of him who both foretold the coming of the world's Savior and pointed him out when he came, May the prayer of the apostles, O Lord, accompany the sacrificial gift that we present to your name for consecration. And may their intercession make us devoted to you in celebration of the sacrifice through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and eternal God, for by the anointing of the Holy Spirit, you made your only begotten Son, High Priest of the new and eternal covenant, and by your wondrous design, were pleased to decree that his one priesthood should continue in the church. For Christ not only adorns with a royal priesthood the people he has made his own, but with a brother's kindness he also chooses men to become sharers in his sacred ministry through the laying on of hands. They are to renew his name, in his name, the sacrifice of human redemption, to set before your children the Paschal banquet, to lead your holy people in charity, to nourish them with the word and strengthen them with the sacraments, as they give up their lives for you and for the salvation of their brothers and sisters. They strive to be conformed to the image of Christ himself and offer you a constant witness of faith and love. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks as in exaltation we acclaim. Most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant, Francis, our Pope, and me, your unworthy servant, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and apostolic faith.
Remember your servants and all who gathered here, whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them, we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true.
In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers in all things, we may be defended by your protecting help.
Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, which we make to you also for me, your unworthy servant, whom you have been pleased to raise to the order of bishops, and in your mercy keep safe your gifts in me, so that what I have received by divine commission, I may fulfill by divine assistance. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect, make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands. And once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
Thank you.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant, Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest, Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing.
Remember also, Lord, your servant. Remember also, Lord, your servant, who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace.
To us also, your servants, who though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. The Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer to one another a sign of peace.
Peace be with you, Bishop.
God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be
healed. let us pray. Grant us, O Lord, who have been renewed by this sacrament, so to live in the church, that persevering in the breaking of the bread and in the teachings of the apostles, we may be one heart and one soul, made steadfast in your love, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated. A few announcements. Wouldn't be a Catholic event without a few announcements. I want to express my gratitude to all of you. I've learned that Tulsa is about 3 hours north of a convenient place to reach, and so I appreciate I appreciate so much the efforts that so many of you went through to be here with me and to celebrate these beautiful liturgies. And I'm very thankful that you've come. You have been a blessing to me. So thank you. There will be refreshments set out on the concourse up there immediately following the service, so we'll have some further time to gather. Recently, I read that when the Creek tribe arrived on the shores of the Arkansas River from Alabama in the 18th century, they had with them a clay pot, and in the clay pot, they had carried coals, live embers, the flame from their council fire, the last one that they burned in Alabama before making the 2-year journey to their new home in Tulsa. And each night on the journey, they would stop and open the pot and rekindle a fire from the live embers, adding new wood to it, burning that wood, telling the stories, living the rituals, and in the morning would take live embers from that fire, put them in the pot, and carry them to the next night's stopping place. We remember that Paul wrote to us in 2 Corinthians that we are clay vessels, that we have been given the priceless gift of the Holy Spirit within us. That Holy Spirit is a fire, a flame of God's love burning within us. And it is our task then, as a people who are on a journey, who are pilgrims, who are heading to our homeland, it is our task on the journey to each day rekindle that fire, to take that flame of faith and to give it to others. So I look forward to the years ahead as we together continue on this journey. Let us pray. The Lord be with you.
Bow down for the blessing.
O God, who care for your people with gentleness and rule them in love, endow with the spirit of wisdom those to whom you have handed on authority to govern, that from the flourishing of a holy flock may come eternal joy for its shepherds.
Amen.
As in your majestic power you allot us the number of our days and the measure of our years, look graciously upon our humble service and confer on our time the full abundance of your peace.
Amen.
Give a happy outcome to the tasks that through your grace you have laid upon me, whom you have raised to the rank of bishop. Make me pleasing to you in the fulfillment of my duties, and so guide the hearts of people and pastor, that the obedience of the flock may never fail the shepherd, nor the care of the shepherd be lacking for the flock.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless all of you gathered here, the Father and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
We thank you, all of you, for joining us today for this wonderful celebration of the ordination of Bishop David Konderla, now the fourth bishop of the Diocese of Tulsa. As we all proceed forth from this gathering place, we ask that you continue to keep him in your prayers. Pray for his ministry here. Pray always for your proper pastor.
And we'd like to ask all of you up here in Oklahoma to take very good care of our Bishop David Konderla, because he will take very good care of you. Thank you all. Good night, and have a wonderful evening. We love you all.
God bless.